Okay, now we are good to go. It is time for our next talk. We've got Maru here from Open Tech and FOSS Asia. We have Daniel from Fab Lab, because that's the lab that's the most fab. And they are going to be talking with us about, is that what you're talking about? This is a transforming collaborative product creation. Okay, so if you have ever wanted to transform collaborative product creation, then this is the talk for you, because that's exactly what they're going to be talking about. So, Mario, Daniel, why don't you guys let us know what this is all about, why you guys are still using Google Chrome. Is that what I see here? and you can explain your life decisions to us here on the stage.
Thank you very much. Yes, okay, so you can hear me. Thanks for this warm welcome, because you guys are excited, because this is Chromium, which is the free and open source version of Chrome. But of course, like I think it's like we shouldn't just be using what like our stuff. I think it's always good to also have a look out what are the others are doing, where's the competition, and this is also what we are working together on here with Daniel and from FabLab Berlin, and the open tech company that I work with in Berlin, and the global community like FOSS Asia and so on. You have seen a lot of activities here over the last few years. We believe we shouldn't only have open source software, free software, like knowledge sharing and so on. We believe we need to extend this to production. We have the big topic here over the last few days, open hardware here, and this has been amazing input here and like conversations, everything that's here at the, I think, one of the best clusters, whereas all the clusters are amazing, and this cluster was just an amazing experience. So thank you very much for you guys here. Yeah, for him, for example, here, for organizing this, Tim, Matthias, Diego, everyone. So that was really awesome. Let's use the remaining time a bit to talk about what we work on. Daniel, how's it with your mic? Yeah? Yes, loud. Yeah, you can hear? Okay, cool. So yeah. Turn it on. Yes.
Hello.
Hands-on approach, exactly.
Very good.
So, cool. Daniel, so let's bring open source, free source, open knowledge, and so on to the next level. What does it mean? What do you think? Hardware? Production? What are your ideas?
For me personally, I think it's like super cool that this whole like software open source thing works so well, and I think it's really nice to try to move that to hardware, but it's so much more complicated because like you have a computer simply and you can play the same software, but with hardware it becomes really more difficult. And like, so we started collaborating in this EU project where it's about production and finding like small and medium enterprises that work already with open source or want to move into the direction of open source hardware. And we have a bunch of cool partners in there. Maybe in a minute we can look through them and like think a little bit about what we can tell you about them already, even though the project is still in a very early stage.
Yeah. So I want to share a bit, like actually over years we talk about this, that it's always a great approach to have the community approach and so on. But like what we see and what is also like, for example, I work with the FOSS Asia community, and it's always great, we collaborate in the community, but then we see these people have developers with great GitHub profiles, they have all this code online, and of course, immediately the big companies come and see these people are great, they hire them. And if you come like from middle class family anywhere in the world, right, it's not just about the philosophy and ideas and this great spirit of sharing that you love, but you also have family pressure, for example. So you have a good job and it pays well, but then Google or Facebook or one of these big ones comes along and says, hey, do you want 4 times or 5 times the salary? Do you want to work on this project? It's not open source, but it's pretty cool. You work together with a bunch of cool other people, right? What would you do? What do you think that many people do?
Yeah, like obviously there is like a search for talents in all kinds of areas, and also in this one. But I personally think like if one wants to do like open source hardware seriously, then of course one should like use open source tools also to develop them. Because like one thing that we notice a lot is like that people use like proprietary software that they're used to in order to make something that they then open source. And it's nice to have like the finished STLs and stuff, but not being able to edit the files, or like you have like Eagle created PCBs and so on, makes it all difficult. And I think it would be really cool if we managed to create a way also for future generations or students that people are encouraged to actually work with open source software on creating open source hardware. And somehow I would really like to have like a pathway to show students that there is there, even though maybe it might be a niche market, but that there is a pathway and that it's actually might be a good choice to learn how to use open software to make open source hardware rather than going the proprietary path.
Yeah. So in our conversation, I think what we are doing here already is we are talking already a little bit what OpenNext is actually about. So OpenNext, like we are like 19 organizations, they're companies, they are universities, they're institutions. We try to work together over the next 3 years, actually not just try, we actually do it. Yeah. So we work together over the next 3 years to like enhance and even create an ecosystem where openness can flourish, and with a specific focus on hardware, which is what I talked about just now, like making really sustainable business models, getting like income for companies that you can pay talents that want to work in openness, but like also need to earn what is necessary to stay in the business. And on the other hand, work with open tools in open hardware. We already have KiCad and other things, and creating the real ecosystem. So maybe let us browse a bit like what we have so far. So we have this amazing website that was done by our friends, for example, from the Danish Design Center. And I want to, we can use this as a start here for going through it like our slides, right? So we're trying to create the internet of product creation, the internet kind of collaborative production. The internet is open, and I think like the internet of production should be open as well. What does it mean? What entails this openness and the internet of product creation? Can you share a bit from your perspective as you're coming from FabLab and your experience?
I think in general, it's like this sustainability aspect is super important. Like, how do you actually manage to create projects that then continue growing or something, and it's not like this one burst of energy and then there is something, but it's hard for other people to connect to it. And the role of FabLabs is also like a not an easy one, because on the one hand, it's clearly like places where ideas happen and like things become more mature and incubated and so on, but at the same time, it's not really clear what the pathways could be. And like one of the questions also that especially Christian Willum from Danish Design Center is asking, like, how can you do it for FabLabs and makerspaces and hackerspaces? What kind of, I don't know, like service path, or what kind of like experience can you offer to, for example, companies that are curious about open hardware, like, and would like to move into this direction? Because I think like at the moment we're mainly working with like pioneers like Mario, who's like already deep into the open source movement. But then there's also this idea of, okay, what happens if there are bigger companies, different companies that would like to move into there? How can one like hold them by the hand and like lead them through the possibilities, discuss all the fears that are there also about like, do I actually like benefit from open sourcing stuff, or is someone gonna take stuff away from me? So it's like,
yeah, that's good. Okay, so and like that already goes with me, like actually in a logic way to our goals. And I think it's a bit small to read, maybe the people online can see it where it's streamed, but maybe we go through these goals, like what does it mean for each of us, for example. OpenNext facilitates wider adoption of open source hardware development practices by businesses. I think we covered that, right? The second goal of our project is we will enable FabLabs to support companies engaging with open source hardware to co-develop products and services with makers and their customers. So is that the core where you see Fab Labs?
I think it's a super important part, definitely, because like in a different project we're working, it's like Caribels, and we're working with like people with like disabilities needs on developing very specific solutions, and it's like it's a very different product development process if you're like sitting there as a team with someone who has a specific need or a specific interest, and then you start like spinning ideas, and then you start figuring out solutions. And I think it's a way of thinking that might be very familiar to us here or something, but I don't think it's necessarily like common sense everywhere in the industry. So I think it's a good thing to facilitate these processes and actually like figure out what to build and how to build it, how to share it afterwards, and like how to enable people to, especially in these cases where it's very individual solutions, it's super nice if you share the blueprint so you can have many, many super individual solutions, and just instead of like just one universal product that doesn't work for most of them.
And I think we should also mention at this point that it is possible for the audience to ask questions, or if they have any comments, because we also want to break down in this project actually, right? This barrier between products and consuming products, right? I mean, it's this whole idea. And nowadays, sustainability, for example, is a big question. So you already mentioned it. And I was thinking like, it wasn't so big question for me anymore, because it was a big question for me personally 10 years ago. And for me, it's like kind of an like in German we say old hat. Do you say that in English? Yeah, it's like a kind of thing like coming back. Yeah. And so I think like we have a lot of answers. And sustainability, you can do open source hardware, so that means you document specifications, you document the whole schematics online, and that means everyone can fix it. Yeah, and we have the sustainability movement that says right to repair. Well, for us it's not even a question, right? I mean, things are open, so all these things are just so natural for us, and I hope we can cooperate with them as well. But I think we can even go steps further and say we develop products and services with makers and their customers, but we can also like then demand that big companies that make devices have to make them open source if they have a certain market share, for example, if they have a monopoly. There are many monopolies in this industry. I mean, like, we could even go up to the level of make airplanes open source, right? Maybe like look at the example of Airbus, look at the example of Boeing. I mean, right? What do you think?
I think it's a tricky thing, but it's like it would be really nice to be able to really follow the development pathways. And it's like as soon as it's closed down, you don't have any chance of like figuring out what the difficulties in there are. What like a personal experience just from like the last weeks, like I was invited to Baghdad to do like a 3D printing workshop in a super cool art space there at Taqib. But because of the demonstrations and like shootings and so on, I was hesitant to go. And so we were like building 3D printers over the internet, basically. I was in Berlin like building a Prusa 3D printer, and they were building two there. And I thought it was like really, like even though there are like minor details that you could do better, I was like super impressed that you can make a manual of like how to build like a super precise machine, like by just providing parts and a manual and like sending it somewhere, and then people are able to actually make this. And of course it's like a lot of work, took like 10 hours, 12 hours, something, but it's like, it's really, it's also really, it feels really good then when you like just like follow these instructions and then actually, it's a really proper, nice, super exact print. I think it's like there's a lot to learn also about how do you make these manuals that they really work properly, and like where like anticipate some confusion that might occur, or like how can you do these things in the best way.
I think that's a good we can move on to goal number three. And I like this point that you just made, because it actually means that is not only about developers or techies, yeah? It's actually about many more people. It's about education, right? The one who's writing the code is not always maybe the best one who understands like how to teach or something like that. Everyone has a passion for something and it overlaps and so on. No, nobody is just like one thing. You also, like you're many persons or have many characteristics, right? But that is important, and that is one thing we're also trying to do here. So I think the third point is kind of clear for everyone in this slide here. It's like we will provide IT solutions to discover and to like really make open source hardware. That's kind of an obvious thing here at the Congress. But like our fourth point here, we will document the journeys of 18 small, medium-sized enterprises that participate in communities to develop open source hardware in the OpenNext program. And this is like what you did in one day, building the
3D
hardware,
printer, yeah,
the 3D printer in Iraq with Baghdad and with communicating with them. But there are many more things. So there's like the whole thing of production and the whole thing of distributing and really getting your product to users, to consumers. And so you already did a lot of this in one day. And I think we will also do this over the next 3 years generally. Right?
Definitely. Like these 18 small and medium-sized enterprises, in the beginning, they're less than 18. The first batch, basically, where OpenTech is one. I'm just trying to scroll down to say a few words about the different partners. 1 second. Oh. So, OpenTech, you can say something about your enterprise.
I think people who in this class already learned a lot about OpenTech. Basically, we are all about openness, but bringing really things to the market. Because what I see, for example, like over many years, we always do cool projects. So we have, for example, we had this project that I really love, the knitting project. We organized MeshCon in Berlin also, and we had these like 60-year-old knitting ladies, yeah. And then we had the math students who worked like with Arduinos and so on and hacked knitting machines, yeah, here from the hackerspace in Munich and so on. So that was really cool, and everyone was really excited and so on. But right, it ends there. You can't like really produce the knitting machines. They're not entirely open. We don't have the infrastructure. We don't have the resources really to bring it to the next level. And I think this is something that we want to do with OpenTech. And this is like in the heart of the program as well. So there's just so much overlap. While I think at the moment we can't do the knitting machines, it's something we will come back for the future. But we have enough other projects. Who was here? You could see Suzy AI. You could see Pocket Science Lab. So this is something we want to focus on. But we also have people who want to build cars. And I think they won't be able to make the entire car open source. But do you have some more infos about Sono Motors, for example, another partner here?
I think they have this revolutionary idea of like bringing electric cars onto the market. And I don't know what the core thing is at the moment. I know that they were raising more money to continue their work and so on. And like, it's also kind of the quest, like in cases like this, what would be the role of a fab lab, for example, to provide something meaningful that's maybe like an open source add-on to some existing project or something? It's because like they have some IP on how to integrate solar panels into cars, what's super great, but that's also their core value. So it should be something that doesn't touch their core business, but still really adds an extra thing. So it's an interesting question. What I wanted to mention with your endeavor also, that I think it's super nice that you, because you're also coming from the software world, that all your products are kind of like hybrid. You have like a hardware component, and at the same time, you have like a strong software component, and this works well together. I think this is also really, really interesting to see.
Thank you. And what I realized is actually we are small, right? I mean, like even though like a lot of some repositories or something you do something, a lot of people start it or like they fork it, right? It's easy. Just a click, right? I mean, but really to engage people. And so I was surprised that we were invited to this program, actually, originally, because I think we are small and others are big, Daimler, Sono Motors, others. But I think it's super important that we work together with these companies and organizations and so on who do things the way they always do it, right? I mean, they have their closed source thing, it's not development operation, everything is really like different, it's not like open like here at the Congress, but they want to change. They also see the need to change. And this is something that I really like. And also to learn about their challenges and helping them in their challenges over the next 3 years, right? For example, if you order, like as a car manufacturer, for example, you have a supplier and this supplier gives you something and it's not open. Yeah, so you have so many different parts. How can you all integrate this and make it open? So it's a long way, and there's always these things that we aren't so interested in, like legal topics. We think we add our license and, you know, we discussed all these licenses, but for them there are many more questions. So there's a lot of
such
work.
Such a bunch of things that one has to look at. It's another two partners, like XYZ Cargo, for example, they're making like cargo bikes. And it's part of like N55 collective, and they have like a open version basically that you're like free to build, and then they have like other versions that they build themselves. And like what seems to be like a big concern to them is like how can one manage that you ensure the quality of your product while making it open for other people to rebuild it, because like there was this thing where someone like rebuilt it, sold it to someone, they weren't included at all in the process, but then suddenly there was something wrong with it or something, so they were coming back to the people that actually put it online, like to the inventors of the product, but they weren't the manufacturers. So a big concern of them is like, yeah, what do we do if people make a bad version of what we put online, and like how does it, on the one hand, like affect our overall
image,
but on the other hand also like are we like by any means liable for that someone else takes this open manual, builds something, gives it to someone else, like where are they? And it's actually, unfortunately, not so easy to answer. Like it's So these are also questions that come up in this process, and that we try to figure out how to do them.
Say again. You mean the license questions in hardware? Yeah.
Somehow I remember with Java it always says you're not allowed to use it for nuclear power plants, and like there's like all this disclaimer thing, and I think the disclaimer, the ways of putting disclaimers into things is easier in software because you're used to the AGB and software licenses. That's one thing. Mm-hmm. And then it's also like with software it's less easy to hurt yourself or something. Like with a bicycle, for example, you can really break a leg or like hurt someone else or something, and so it's kind of like, and there are also other rule sets that imply like certifications and like tests and so on, so it's not super So it's different.
So I think these questions are not just about like the licenses, they're about legal questions in general, and there's also the question about the image and the brand, right? I mean, if you deploy software, you deploy it somewhere else, it's the same software. Yeah, of course you can still do a lot, mess it up, right? Configurations, whatnot. But it's the same software. Whereas if you do hardware and you want to have certain brand image, you know, and yeah. So this is what companies that already earn money, yeah, they are worried that will change. And for example, like they have all kinds of legal questions that nobody has answered before. It's like us. Somebody has answered this question in the software world. Okay, we can just repeat it, yeah? We can just do it again. And these companies here, they said, okay, we are not always open source companies like we are already, right? But we are companies who want to do that step, and they get on board, and this is really amazing. We have a car manufacturer now on board that is starting to sell cars this year already. They're producing, they will be selling 10,000 cars hang on, this year, I'm talking about 2020, yeah? So we're so close. So they are selling these cars soon. So this is not like a small like a team of people who say, yeah, we have an idea to make a car. They are doing it right now. And they are talking about open hardware on executive level with several hundred people working for them. So that's quite an amazing thing. And that's what we're doing here on the EU level. And we have here another company, which is Sticker. Sticker, how do you...
Yeah, Sticker. Yeah. What's really cool about them is that they, like from what I understood so far, is that they make furniture, but like custom for buildings. So if you exactly have the space of the stage, for example, and you want to fit certain things, then they have like designs that where you can like, yeah, get these things produced exactly to the measurements you want. So basically like parametric furniture. And they're really interested in having more furniture designs and so on and be able to produce them so customers have a larger selection of things that they can go through.
Yeah. So questions that they all also were asking about the designs, and they are not always clear about what income models, because they also want their designers to have an income models. They want designers to use their services, for example, and they wonder if all these designs are for free, how can the designers make money? Some designers already live on a shoestring. Yeah. So they're asking these questions, and designers are also asking these questions. We had this big thing with Creative Commons and non-commercial licenses and this and that. Like whatever license you choose for Creative Commons, I didn't see really business models coming up with these Creative Commons licenses different to like the open source software license and open source software. There's a lot of models, income in this area. So they're asking this, how can we work with the community? How can we open up things and at the same time ensure income for designers, for example? And that's an exciting part to explore and to talk about.
Fiction Factory was very fun. We were visiting Fiction Factory recently for our consortium meeting, and they have one product that's kind of like a side company. It's called Wickelhaus, and it's like a cardboard tiny houses, basically. So they have this huge machine that takes cardboard, like a big roll of cardboard, and spins it around like a huge metal, shape or like a mold or something, and like glues it, and then they have one element for the house, and you can like have a few elements and have like a kitchen inside and a bathroom and all these things. This is really, really cool. And in general, they make a lot of, for fairs and everything, they do a lot of like individual production of interiors of like fair things and so on. And I also stayed in a hotel that's a boat actually. And like, so they made this logo of the boat on top as single rooms. So you could like stay in each of these single characters. So they do all these kind of things, and now they want to like improve like an existing laser cutter design and get their hands dirty within this. It's literally a factory actually. Like it's really like a factory for individual solutions.
Yeah. And I always like that we have a European partner. So this this idea of like doing business across Europe and like making this program, right? I mean, like not just the big companies, but really like working with research partners. They are in Amsterdam, so we had a good time there. And really, really nice. The laser cutter thing, I want to say, like just by doing the workshop there, we talked to so many engineers, and they didn't really have this idea of opening up production. I mean, like, right, when you work with companies, there's always your contact, and not everyone talks with every team every day. But because our group of people was there, suddenly the whole company is into openness. I talked 1 hour with the engineer who wanted to do the laser cutter, and suddenly after 1 hour he said, oh yeah, we really have to do this open source. That is very high on our agenda now, right? So it's really fun to change these kind of things and to work together with people. And we have soda here. Where were they? They're also in the Netherlands.
Or was it in
Netherlands. In the Netherlands.
It's in the Netherlands. Exactly. No, but like the thing that stuck to my head was that they're doing like open trackers for animals. So wildlife tracking solutions and probably a whole bunch of other like
IoT things, and like also they put sensor systems on bicycles, so like when everyone rides their bike, you could collect like environmental data and so on at the same time to create things. But it's like, yeah, I was especially intrigued by the animal tracking systems. Yeah.
And I talked to them about if they can use our Pocket Science Lab, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, that could be an open hardware thing that we can start to collaborate on. Yeah.
Cool. Maybe we can use some more minutes. I don't know how many we have to learn a little bit more.
Two more minutes. We have 2 more minutes.
Okay.
So I think we're getting to the end, and maybe we can take 2 questions. So just to maybe use this. So we already had some interaction with the audience, which was really cool. Go ahead.
This on? Can you hear me? Okay. I have 2 friends who separately decided to manufacture 3D printers, and one of them was doing pretty well. But when he tried to scale up his activities, like to sell it on like a bigger store or an official store, they requested that he have like a CE certification for his products. Mm-hmm. And I guess that's a pretty bureaucratic process. So would an organization like yours also provide consulting for like getting these certifications so that small manufacturers can actually scale up your activity into like big platforms?
Yeah. Well, what product was it?
3D printers.
Yeah, I think it's like there's a lot of rules basically that on the one hand ensure, I don't know, like safety and so on, but on the other hand they're also a big advantage for bigger players. So it's a little bit like, I don't know, like you're often in Asia, there are a lot of like street food places and so on, and that's just amazing because there's so much happening. If you wanted to do the same thing here, it would be really difficult because everyone would need like special permission and so on. And it's kind of this double-sword situation. And especially in the, like, for example, open healthcare thing, it's even harder because like there's of course even more rules that apply. And I think it would be super nice to like, I think everything that we figure out, we definitely will share on information, but I'm not sure yet how easy it is or like what the best ways are to guide through these processes. But how does it work, for example, with Pocket Science Lab?
Yeah.
Do you have like these logos on there?
Of course we investigated. So there are a lot of questions to this. And I think like, so we are at the beginning of this collaboration around Europe. And the goal is really to have a framework at the end that, for example, companies can follow, projects can follow. So this is a program like focus on consumer products. So the goal is really like bring things to the market, bring open source hardware to the market. And the idea is to have a framework at the end. What do I need to do if I have an idea? Or what do I need to do if I have my company and I want to make one of my products into open source? And not all the questions are always like, how can I release the source code? There are practical questions. How can I get the certificate and when do I need it? For example, we actually don't need it because we don't have a battery on it. But actually, if we have this symbol, then maybe more people would buy it. Yeah, they would say, oh yeah, that's somehow secure. Yeah, so actually some of the Raspberry Pi, they don't need the RoHS or something like that symbol because they don't have any liquid in there and so on, but they still have it. Yeah, because I think these are practical questions that we could also cover there because these are like, you don't have a legal department to do that, right? But we want to help other projects, inspire them and help them practically. How can they move from project to real open hardware? And I think like one last question, yeah? No more last questions. But yes.
Yeah.
So we take it over. We are still here for a little bit, like there behind us, our cluster. You're also there. So please join us, talk to us, and maybe there are already ideas for collaboration. Thank you very much, Daniel,
thank
for
you.
Joining this.
That's yeah, good.
Was great. And thank you very much for giving us the opportunity. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mario and Daniel. You know that sound of somebody kicking a bottle, I have grown used to that sound over the course of C3. It is the most prevalent sound that I have ever heard, and it's beautiful to see. But yes, we got Mario and Dan over here. They're going to be over by the FOSS Asia table. We want to push them away from us as much as possible on the stage, just because, oh yeah, no, by all means, come take your thing.